Tantar Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Mind Over Media, Propaganda Education for a Digital Age by Renee Hobbs. Foreword by Douglas Rushkoff. Narrated by Rosemary Benson. Publisher's Note: This audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantar.com and type Mind Over Media into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page. Then, under the Supplemental Content section, please enter the access code MEME, and then click the Unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. All figures and tables referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Foreword. I suppose it's fitting that our era's most important book on propaganda should come disguised as a teacher's guide to the subject. After all, this is the era of insiders. We all see behind the curtain all the time. We are no longer mere consumers or voters. We are amateur product spokespeople and political commentators. We don't simply read the headlines or watch television. We tweet captions and make YouTube videos. You may think that in this context, to read a book about propaganda would be almost pointless, a purely academic exercise. It may have sufficed in an era when propaganda was a form of media content, something we could deconstruct in order to neutralize. But what about when propaganda is no longer relegated to the content of media, but becomes the context itself? Books, radio, and television offered us mostly self-contained universes we entered voluntarily. A TV show or news report could influence us, but it did so largely through storytelling. The sentencing of a criminal at the end of Dragnet or Law and Order taught us that crime doesn't pay. The editing of war footage into narratives let broadcasters choose which side we should root for. We ended up living in a world of stories, each of which is fed back into reality. Everything we saw on TV influenced our behavior, which in turn influenced what happened in the real world. If local news stories convinced us that the streets were dangerous, we stayed inside at night, making the streets more empty and dangerous. If a public relations professional could convince us that holding a cigarette was a symbol of female power, more women would actually choose to smoke in public, abolishing a former stigma. But this sort of public relations always depended on elite media professionals capable of crafting a story and then delivering it to us through newspapers, movies, or TV. This was the province of Woodrow Wilson and FDR, William Randolph Hearst and Rupert Murdoch, or Ed Bernays and Howard Rubinstein. And all we really had to do in order to diffuse the power of stories, from Triumph of Will to Top Gun, was to analyze the content and maybe look at the companies behind the scenes. Today, the story behind the scenes is the story. In reality TV, the story is inconsequential. It's the setup that matters, the context. Cops isn't about any particular arrest, but the nature of law enforcement in working-class America. What you gonna do when they come for you? American Idol doesn't highlight its individual performers so much as the primacy of corporate pop and the willingness of artists to surrender to the judges and remake themselves in more commercial packages. Survivor epitomizes the cutthroat ethos of the competitive marketplace. And reality television, as a genre, promotes the notion that getting on TV, by any means necessary, is worth the humiliation and self-degradation. The footage may be real, but the producers get to assemble whatever reality they choose from it. It's like the news, except with no obligation to the truth. Our collective ignorance of how this new propaganda landscape functions matters. It's why we elected a reality television star as president. We mistook cops for America, American Idol's popularity contest for democracy, and the star of The Apprentice for a successful businessman. Media literacy used to mean being able to read the media, deconstruct the story, and decode what they mean for us to believe or do. But in a digital environment, media literacy means being able to engage with the environment, tools, and platforms of media itself. When you watch a YouTube video, the content of that clip is only one small part of its influence over you. Less recognized, but equally influential, are its number of views, search ranking, description, and comments. YouTube exercises its propagandistic pull less through individual videos than through the sequence of videos recommended by its algorithms. Those algorithms are watching us much more intently than we're watching the videos, and their sole objective is to get us to click on more. Likewise, where we may have once valued our ability to look at a Facebook post and understand its rhetorical power, that is no longer sufficient. Facebook is not like a TV channel or newspaper. It is an entire environment designed to change the way we think and act. Only an analysis of the platform as propaganda will reveal to us the way Facebook really works. The network uses data we leave behind in order to put us into statistical buckets of people who are likely to behave in a certain way. Then, they use everything at their disposal to make sure we behave true to our algorithmically derived statistical profiles. So, say Facebook determines that you are in a group of people who have an 80% likelihood of going on a diet in the next 3 weeks. The next thing you know, you'll begin seeing particular kinds of posts fill your newsfeed. Articles about people who have died from obesity or clogged arteries, posts from friends of friends who went on a successful diet, and so on. The objective is not simply to advertise a particular marketer's diet products, but to increase the accuracy of their predictions by whittling down the 20% of people who may have done something other than going on a diet. The platform means to increase our predictability. Or compare your Google search results to those of your best friend or your parents. Search for the same words and see how differently Google responds. Better yet, log in through an IP address in a different neighborhood or country. Take a look at the difference between the Google search results for the word Jew in America, Europe, and Jordan. Those are the sorts of experiences that change your understanding of the media architecture we are inhabiting. And they're the sorts of experiences Renee Hobbs offers us, our students, and our children in this book. Media is no longer something we watch. It is something we do. The only way for us to have a fighting chance at autonomy in such a constructed reality is to gain our bearings through experiential learning. There is no map. There is only territory. You have to walk it to know it. And when you do, you'll be rather surprised to find out that there may not really be anyone in charge. There's no big brother at the top of the media hierarchy, crafting messages to trickle down through the mass media we consume. No, there's no one at the wheel. The companies responsible for mediating and representing our reality are run largely by people who have no aim other than to collect our data and get us to click on more stuff. And they've relinquished authority over their networks and content to the algorithms, which are just doing whatever they can to trigger our brainstems and get us to click. Whether that means showing us a shark attack, a racist diatribe, or fake news from Russia, it doesn't matter. We're no longer living in a world where propaganda is being used against us, so much as one made of propaganda itself. That's why this book is so important. This is the first step toward regaining human comprehension and control over the tools and platforms that comprise our shared communication space. It is at once an engaging chronicle of how we got here, a handbook for understanding propaganda, a course in experiential learning, and a collection of ways to discuss and confront the greatest challenges to human flourishing in the coming century. Reading Mind Over Media should convince you that it's not too late to take back control, not just of the media, but also of our own thought processes. The power to change everything is in your hands right now. Douglas Rushkoff, New York, 2019. Preface. Let's admit it. Propaganda is a word with a bad reputation. Perhaps you think that the word has been thrown around indiscriminately in the past few years. You may be inclined to think that propaganda is something associated with totalitarian regimes from the past. Or perhaps you think of propaganda as government-sponsored spreading of lies and misinformation. Perhaps you think of propaganda as unethical effort to distort people's sense of social reality through the endless display of ever-changing tweets and memes in a world where Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and Google seem to rule. You have certainly encountered many purposefully manufactured stories from politicians, governments, businesses, activists, and special interest groups who aim to sway public opinion, quash critics, or sow discord. For many people, propaganda is a term of abuse to hurl at rivals and opponents. If you really dislike a particular news story, social media post, or YouTube video, if it outrages or offends you, or if you think it's harmful, dangerous, irresponsible, or just flat out wrong, just call it propaganda. But propaganda is so much more interesting and complicated than all that. Propaganda contributes its share to the infodemic, a term the World Health Organization has used during the coronavirus pandemic to describe the avalanche of information that people must sift through to make decisions about their health and safety. Propaganda can be found in entertainment, education, and the management of public opinion, where ideas about moral character and ethical values become embedded into the fabric of culture. Propaganda has helped to shape your sense of personal identity through religious, commercial, or entertainment narratives that depict what it means to lead a good life. Depending on your point of view, the good life may include caring for your family, traveling the world, honoring people with disabilities, or even appreciating the timeless beauty of expensive watches. In schools, many educators keep discussions of propaganda comfortably in the past, exploring it only when studying World War II Germany. As one critic put it, propaganda is something most of us read about in history class and wondered how people were so easily duped. And although teaching and learning about historic propaganda is important, this book primarily addresses the propaganda that is a part of everyday life. There's never been a more important time to learn about contemporary propaganda. New digital forms of propaganda are influencing both the public and policymakers, as bots amplify certain ideas to create an illusion of popularity, and trolls attack people with the goal of silencing or marginalizing ideas they hate. Propaganda is big business, disseminated through personalization algorithms and machine learning. Digital platforms make it easier than ever to use techniques like sentiment analysis, where natural language processing, text analysis, and computational linguistics help propagandists identify, evaluate, and respond to people's expression of emotion in ordinary online interactions. Today, many people are engaged in the production of compelling propaganda. Political leaders around the world make use of it to influence public opinion. Conspiracy theories and lies have been used to demean leaders of foreign countries, government agencies, and political foes alike, Sometimes, propagandists use anger or outrage to grab attention. Other times, they repeat simple slogans over and over until they become mindless but memorable clichés. Others use more sophisticated techniques. Disinformation specialists are adept at online manipulation campaigns that trick journalists into reporting false information. Some propagandists even create think tanks and build up their authority by producing research that supports their preferred position. This kind of propaganda may influence policymakers, who end up with a distorted perception of issues that are important to the public. Propaganda thrives on conflict. Mass media and social media can cultivate us-versus-them narratives that dehumanize the other and increase people's willingness to participate in conflict. Sadly, many people have embraced hate speech as part of political discourse. We have become desensitized to it and even experience outrage as a form of entertainment. You may barely recall the shock of reading about Donald Trump's insistence that President Barack Obama was not a U.S. citizen. Today, you may shrug when he labels immigrants as criminals and tells Americans that their elected political leaders and military generals are morons and babies. Propaganda has contributed high-octane gas to accelerate the growing political polarization we are seeing all around the world. Some days, it can be exhilarating. Other days, it can feel tragic. As Los Angeles Times TV critic Lorraine Ali pointed out, it's the mark of a country we never wanted to be, a nation that divides its own people and pits them against one another. Throughout history, propagandists have chosen whether to unify or divide people, depending on their strategic goals. Demagogues simplify complex realities by making wild promises, using the power of emotion to activate people's feelings of trust and loyalty. Anyone who opposes the demagogue is labeled an enemy, which then incites a spirited us-versus-them energy that can be difficult to unravel. This kind of leadership can be appealing to many, but it is anathema to democracy. Scapegoating is used to focus blame. By insulting and trying to damage the reputation of anyone who dares to challenge them, demagogues aim to silence or marginalize opponents. The ancient Greeks warned us that demagogues intentionally widen social cleavages, playing one group of citizens against another. The result can become a tyrannical abuse of power. On key issues like poverty, healthcare, education, immigration, the federal debt, foreign policy, and more, propaganda plus demagoguery spells trouble. As Raymond explains, political divisions become almost impossible to bridge, which dissuades elected officials with differing viewpoints from deliberating together. Without consensus, the democratic process does not work. Sadly, as we are seeing now in the public sphere, it's far easier to divide than to unite. Given the complex political context of today, how can propaganda be productively studied in the elementary school, the high school, or the college classroom? Ironically, the first step involves appreciating propaganda instead of demonizing it. Propaganda, as a powerful form of expression and communication, must not be positioned as the fall guy for all the world's woes. Propaganda is a vital part of the democratic process, providing opportunities for exposure to diverse ideas and inducing people to act together. Activists create propaganda when they stage a protest march, a rally, or any other public event filled with songs, chants, and inspiring speeches. Public health officials create propaganda when they develop targeted ad campaigns to help people make informed decisions about their health. Documentary filmmakers create propaganda when they explain why urgent attention is needed to address the climate emergency resulting from the 40 billion tons of carbon dioxide humans pump into the atmosphere each year. You may contribute to propaganda's viral nature when you like or share a social media post about police brutality and racism, or even when you share a compelling political campaign ad. When propaganda appeals to genuinely democratic values, it can increase people's awareness of the dangers of authoritarian and fascist ideologies. In fact, there is a long history of public conversation regarding how a society aspiring to democracy may balance the right to persuade with the right of the public to free choice. Because it simplifies information and ideas, propagandists can help people experience moral clarity about issues and events that most concern them. Propaganda that speaks to people's deepest values bypasses the head and goes straight for the heart. It breaks through the clutter of everyday life. Teaching and learning about propaganda can be a transformative experience for both students and teachers alike. When done well, the study of propaganda can embody fundamental practices of literacy and civic education in the context of inquiry learning. Propaganda education can activate intellectual curiosity. It can promote multi-perspectival thinking and help people more accurately read the digital environments we inhabit, helping us make better decisions. It can be a means to resist demagoguery and even help to cure the disease of political polarization. But there's no magic wand, no defensive armor, vaccine, or potion that can inoculate people against the pernicious influence of propaganda. Education alone cannot solve the epistemological crisis of the present time, when social media amplifies false, dangerous, and repugnant ideas, and political leaders lie with impunity. Education alone cannot erase the fear that leads people to become vulnerable to false but emotionally resonant messages. Education alone cannot eliminate the damage caused by inequality, racism, greed, and the long-standing abuse of power by institutions and individuals with authority and expertise. But education about contemporary propaganda is essential for people of all ages who want to hold on to their democracy in the face of threats. Propaganda predates the internet by millennia, and this book acknowledges that people have been recognizing, resisting, and falling for the allure of propaganda since well before the time of the sophists in ancient Greece. Responsible leaders themselves have navigated the dilemma of trying to be an ethical communicator when, as one scholar put it, the business of manipulating public opinion inevitably pushes towards the use of whatever techniques work. The study of propaganda provides plentiful opportunities to address values, ethics, and morality. In this book, I argue that as people activate critical thinking skills in recognizing and responding to propaganda, they increase autonomy and personal freedom. As the emotional jolts and the promise of simple solutions and easy answers become easier to spot, people can use the power of inquiry, dialogue, and reflection to evaluate propaganda's explicit and implicit claims. They can appreciate how propaganda can be interpreted in different ways. As people understand how propaganda works, they are empowered to become propagandists themselves by creating and sharing media. In using the power of communication and information to make a difference in the world, they have an opportunity to deepen awareness of the moral and ethical tensions that are built into the practice of persuasion. People can learn to discern between propaganda that is designed for personal benefit and propaganda that is trying to benefit society. But because no one is immune from the power of propaganda, the pedagogy of propaganda education can be controversial, and it must be designed and implemented with care so that it does not turn into indoctrination. When done well, propaganda education does not increase cynicism, suspicion, distrust, and alienation. You'll discover that an optimistic and empowering approach to teaching and learning about propaganda is relevant for every learner in every discipline or field of study, from kindergarten to graduate school, and across the lifespan, in and out of school. 1. Mind over media. Propaganda is responsive to changes in culture, technology, and society. When the staff of the National Archives Museum in Washington, D.C. were developing an exhibit entitled Rightfully Hers, American Women and the Vote, they wanted to examine the history of the struggle of women to gain the right to vote. In developing a way to connect the present to the past, they created a unique and attention-getting display for the elevator lobby. They combined a large, historic image of a 1913 photo of a women's demonstration on Pennsylvania Avenue with an image from a 2017 women's march in Washington, D.C., using a lenticular printing technique, which enables viewers to see the 1913 photo from one vantage point and also see the contemporary photo by looking at the image from a slightly different point of view. Since the election of President Donald Trump in 2016, thousands of demonstrators have gathered annually in Washington, D.C., and 250 other cities for a protest. These boisterous annual gatherings feature people of all ages carrying provocative signs, chanting slogans, and wearing those now famous pussy hats. But when the Washington Post reported in early 2020 that the image of the Women's March at the National Archives exhibit on women's protests had been edited to remove certain words on the signs held by the protest marchers, it reminded some of 1984, the dystopian novel by George Orwell. There, the protagonist, Winston Smith's job is to revise history on behalf of Big Brother. As a non-political federal agency, the National Archives staff decided to obscure the protest signs that commented on Trump's misogyny, and they removed words relating to female genitalia. They blurred a sign that stated, "God hates Trump," and one that read, "Trump and GOP, hands off women." In their careful design of the exhibit's promotional materials, the staff at the National Archives simply wanted to avoid political controversy. The government employees at the National Archives were not intending to create propaganda, but their editorial decision was perceived by some as an intentional distortion of history for propaganda purposes. Their action seemed to neutralize the highly partisan nature of political expression at the Women's March. When the news about the altered photo was released, a firestorm of criticism erupted on social media as a wide variety of people were infuriated that the federal agency responsible for preserving our nation's history would distort photographic evidence. Soon after, the National Archives issued a formal apology letter and removed the display, noting that the photo they used was not an archival record, but one they had merely licensed to use as a promotional graphic. But one critic explained, "The photographs of the Women's March are not only photographs of events in our history. They are the artifactual records we have of our freedom of speech and assembly. The documents showing hundreds of thousands went into streets that day to raise their voices about their worries and their dreams." Such a simple form of image manipulation may seem pale in comparison to the more sophisticated and radical forms of image manipulation that now circulate online. Deep fake videos take advantage of machine learning to create highly convincing, unreal realities, making someone appear to say or do something he or she did not say or do. For example, in Europe, many Dutch-speaking viewers saw a short Facebook video of Donald Trump making a speech that asked Belgium to withdraw from the Paris Climate Agreement. In the video, which is in English but has Dutch subtitles, a very realistic-looking fake Trump says, "As you know, I had the balls to withdraw from the Paris Climate Agreement, and so should you." At the very end of the video, the fake Trump says, "We all know climate change is fake, just like this video." But this last line is not translated into Dutch in the subtitles. For the many Facebook viewers who watched the video without volume, reading only the subtitles, it looked very real indeed. Since then, hundreds of news stories have claimed that deepfake technology is a new kind of propaganda that will soon be sweeping the internet. Naturally, people fear that the software could be used to cause political damage. One expert explained, "If deepfakes make people believe they can't trust video, the problems of misinformation and conspiracy theories could get worse." A convincing deepfake could further diminish our trust in audio and video as reliable sources of information. Fortunately, computer scientists are finding ways for machine learning to detect deepfakes, and Facebook is already using a system to filter for doctored video at the point of upload. Some critics point out deepfakes haven't taken off as propaganda because the public can be manipulated much more easily without all those technological bells and whistles. When a video of U.S. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi circulated online, showing her with artificially slowed speech, reporters pointed out that the Pelosi video did not use deepfake technology, but much simpler audio editing tools. Propaganda videos have created havoc round the world. One video depicted a person being burned alive. The video was relabeled multiple times to make it look like it came from Ivory Coast, South Sudan, Kenya, and Burma. In each case, the mislabeled video led to violent actions in each country and caused harm to innocent people. Although videos using these simple techniques have been called cheap fakes, they are not new. You may remember that in 2010, Fox News aired a highly edited video created by Andrew Breitbart of a speech by Shirley Sherrod, an official in the Obama administration, that made it appear as if she was a racist. The resulting brouhaha led to Sherrod getting fired from her position at the U.S. Department of Agriculture in 2010. Only after the damage was done was it discovered that the video was intentionally designed to harm Sherrod's reputation and manipulate public opinion. Since then, this form of propaganda has become commonplace. And doctored photos, deep fakes, and cheap fakes are just the tip of the iceberg. Propaganda comes in wide variety of forms and genres because it is an inescapable feature of everyday life. It may be created intentionally or unintentionally. It may occur when people try to influence attitudes and behaviors by evoking strong emotions, attacking opponents, simplifying information, and appealing to the deepest hopes, fears, and dreams of a target audience. But first, we must consider how definitions of propaganda reflect changes in culture, technology, and media, and see how contemporary propaganda takes many forms, including some that can be challenging to spot. The propaganda formula. There's a timeless pattern to many forms of propaganda, one that's rooted in both problems and solutions. As a propagandist, when you are promoting a solution, you intensify it using repetition, positive feelings, and careful design and composition. you make that solution seem like the best thing in the world. When you have a problem on your hands, you downplay it through omission, diversion, and creating confusion. Downplaying and intensifying are neither good nor evil. They are rhetorical practices that aim to influence people to accept a version of reality that meets the needs of the person doing the persuading. You might be inclined to blame social media and the internet as the cause of propaganda's cultural dominance today. From an economic point of view, propaganda is rising in visibility and influence due to the attention economy, where an explosive array of choices are now available to us as both consumers and creators of media. In this global information network, anyone can produce digital content. People can easily use the classic formula of sensationalism, with its focus on sex, violence, children, animals, and the mysterious unknown, to profit from viral sharing, where more clicks equal more revenue. When people use emotionally intense words or images, their messages spread to reach a larger audience. Delight, surprise, anger, and outrage are not merely emotions. They are attention-getting tools. The impact of these strategies is evident in the home, the workplace, and in public life. Not only does digital propaganda evoke strong feelings, but today we're often not sure what kinds of content we can trust. When we hear the same ideas and phrases over and over, they begin to seem true. Finding and evaluating the source of information can be challenging. Often the real funder of propaganda is disguised or hidden, as when organizations that deliver messages choose not to reveal the funding sources that support them. Because most Americans get their news from social media, we often experience content as headlines and snippets, without source information or context clues to assist in interpretation. Today, propaganda takes new digital forms that blur the lines between entertainment, information, and persuasion. If you look around, you'll see that people who use propaganda techniques of intensifying and downplaying are often the most respected people in a community simply because they are compelling, effective communicators. Ministers, community leaders, elected public officials, educators, media professionals, and even celebrities are aware that, as professional communicators who aim to coalesce public opinion, they face important ethical questions in their relationship with audiences. They make their case using the power of language to engage audiences emotionally and intellectually. They also choose whether to tell the truth, to stretch the truth, to lie by omission, or to make stuff up. Everyone knows that an educator can inspire with positive words and expressions of emotion, or use threats or negative evaluation to gain compliance. A politician makes a choice to inspire and unify people, or divide by lying, bullying, and name-calling. An activist who speaks at a public event can inspire people by painting a mental picture of the changed world they seek, or attack opponents with a withering critique. Intensifying and downplaying can occur through visual symbols as well as words. Consider the graphic designer who creates an infographic on global energy. She may rely on factual information to depict the differing levels of consumption of coal, gas, hydroelectric, wind, and other forms of energy. She will inevitably use subtle visual messages to signify the value of coal or solar in the design, color, and layout of the images and charts. Readers generally cannot directly interrogate the author to determine authorial intent, but clues in the language, imagery, color, design, and choice of informational content all provide tacit evidence of the author's point of view and strategic goals. While it's critically important to analyze propaganda, it's also important to learn how to create it. When you create propaganda, you discover that it's a challenging task that requires discipline, imagination, and tenacity. You also learn that propaganda is not always effective. Learning to create propaganda prepares students for life in a democratic society, because propaganda is a major way that people try to influence public opinion and make social change. Although many people think propaganda is purely negative, the term also applies to messages that are intended to be used for beneficial and socially desirable purposes. Perhaps you have seen the inspiring YouTube video that features Asian American singer-songwriter Clara Chung, who describes her favorite middle school music teacher, a woman who helped her realize that she could make choices to achieve her dreams. This video on the power of teaching was funded by the White House Department of Education's Initiative on Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders. Produced by Jubilee, a media company by changemakers for changemakers, the music and the story combine to evoke feelings about the importance of teachers in the lives of young people. Videos like this may provide viewers with positive feelings about the role of educators in American society. By touching the heartstrings and reminding us of the importance of good teachers, you may be more likely to share a link to the video with your circle of friends and family. You may not think of videos like this as a form of propaganda, but they are. The study of propaganda is profoundly linked to the mission of education and civic learning in American schools. If schools are to fulfill their social purpose of preparing people for life in a democratic society, there's a need to help learners make sense of contemporary propaganda and use the power of inquiry to explore it. I'm deeply committed to this goal. That's why you'll find a wide variety of learning activities that offer examples of how to integrate propaganda education into any curriculum. At the companion website, mindovermedia.us, you'll find additional online learning resources. In an appendix, you'll find a complete list of learning activities presented throughout the book. These learning activities have two purposes. They are designed to help general readers visualize the instructional practices of media literacy education, and they may also jumpstart the creativity and imagination of educators who are looking for creative strategies for exploring the topic of propaganda with their students. Persuasion, information, entertainment, and power. The relationship between propaganda and persuasion is complicated. These two terms are very closely related and have been debated and discussed for thousands of years. Both refer to efforts that use communication and symbolic expression to influence people's beliefs, attitudes, and behaviors. Scholars have defined persuasion in relation to a communicator's intention to change or reinforce the beliefs, attitudes, or behaviors of another. To identify elements of persuasion, terms from classical Greek rhetoric are often used to acknowledge how persuasion occurs through these modes: the credibility and character of the speaker, ethos; the quality of ideas presented, logos; and the emotions activated in the listener, pathos. Persuasion also occurs in a particular context at the right moment in time, kairos. The term propaganda refers to a form of persuasion that aims to influence the beliefs, attitudes, and behaviors of a large audience, not just a single individual or small group. Before the rise of social media, some scholars used to generally think of persuasion as part of interpersonal communication, while the term propaganda referred to mass communication. You would typically use the term persuasion to describe how you convinced your friends to try that new restaurant, while you could use the term propaganda when referring to a television public service announcement on the importance of preventing forest fires. But today, you probably see the blurriness between the two terms. With the rise of the internet and social media, the distinction between mass communication and interpersonal communication is eroding because so many of our important social relationships are now mediatized. We now interact daily with friends and family through social media, sharing images, textual language, and recorded music and sound. Your text messages may reach a few people or many. A photo that you share on your Facebook may reach a large audience under some conditions. Misunderstanding and confusion can result when content intended for a single individual is read or seen by a mass audience. In some cases, it can even create dangerous risks and potential harm. When interpersonal and mass communication collide, the meaning of a message in one context can be transformed by its shift into another context, a concept that has become known as context collapse. When people share content online, nearly any message has the capacity and potential to go viral and reach a wide, diverse audience. Propaganda is not merely a type of persuasion. It also stands at the intersection of information and entertainment. The versatility of propaganda to inform, entertain, and persuade is why it is used by those in power or those who seek power. Throughout history, military, religious, and political leaders have all used informational propaganda to accomplish their goals. For example, the Athenian naval commander Themistocles tricked his opponent with false information about the location and movement of his troops. Julius Caesar created his own fantastic and entertaining legends about himself to make him appear to be supernatural, inspiring the awe of the public. The Catholic popes told atrocity stories about Muslims to inspire the Crusades, while Protestant reformer Martin Luther used entertaining dialogues in his printed sermons to expose the corruption of the Pope, activating people's emotions. Information, art, culture, and entertainment can all function as propaganda. Writers, artists, and activists use stories, music, paintings, photography, or film to express ideas about possible worlds, in the hope that they will shape and influence public opinion. Through propaganda, people can connect new information to people's existing beliefs, strategically using information to create unreal realities. The information provided by a propagandist may be true, partly true, false, or even pants on fire false. During the Enlightenment, propagandists used satire and political cartoons to express their ideas. American colonists portrayed minor skirmishes, at Lexington and Concord, as major victories, and even the Declaration of Independence was designed as a form of propaganda to influence public opinion and justify the need for political independence. A variety of 19th-century popular American authors, like Harriet Beecher Stowe and Mark Twain, used the power of fictional stories to imaginatively blend realistic events into fictional narratives in ways that addressed larger emotional truths about racism and inequality. During the Civil War, photography was a new technology that enabled people to see the horrors of the battlefield. Some photographers expressed their sentiments about the tragic loss of life by moving the dead bodies into dramatic positions and occasionally adding props to intensify the drama of the visual image. By the 19th century, propaganda was fully institutionalized as part of the democratic political process and it was fueled by the rise of newspapers and magazines, which enabled politicians to more easily reach vast audiences. Political philosophers began to comment on the ways in which the increasingly sophisticated activation of both emotion and reason was influencing the practice of civic decision-making. Entertaining fictions can sometimes function more effectively as propaganda than information. While the greater availability of political information enables people to learn more about politics and the political process, many people take advantage of greater choice of content to tune out of politics completely. The blurring of entertainment and propaganda can be observed by simply noticing how entertainment techniques have become commonplace in political discourse, and how political and social topics are embedded in music, movies, TV shows, and video games. Creative producers, musicians, athletes, and celebrities often embed political messages into movies, television, music, sports, and art. Because people let down their critical guard when they are being entertained, they may fail to notice how deeply propaganda messages are embedded in spectacle or amusement. Entertainment storytelling has long helped to shape social norms. At the turn of the 20th century, audiences thrilled to D.W. Griffith's Birth of a Nation because of its epic and visually compelling storytelling. But the film also depicted post-Civil War Reconstruction in ways that presented Black leaders as dangerous and evil. The racist political ideology expressed in the film outraged many African-American leaders and white liberals. But the film's emotional power emboldened white politicians and inspired efforts to quash the political and social rights of African-Americans through overtly discriminatory practices in law, real estate, education, business, transportation, and public life. Storytelling can be used to sell lifestyles. In the 1930s, Hollywood studios released sponsored films that were disguised advertising for cars, clothes, and new houses. By the middle of the century, critics observed that entertainment film could convey powerful ideological messages about society and politics. Today, first-person military shooter games prepare children and young people for combat training. Video games also connect the military with potential recruits. Journalists have documented the relationship between U.S. military recruiting and the video game industry. Even professional soldiers easily recognize how first-person shooter games function as propaganda for war. The internet and meme culture bring even more entertaining propaganda to our doorstep. According to artist and activist An Chao Mina, it's the silly stuff of the internet that opens the door to social activism. Selfies, YouTube parodies, and cat videos are intertwined with human rights and social justice issues, storytelling, and culture. For example, in the spring of 2016, during the debate about whether the United Kingdom should leave the European Union, the hashtag #CatsAgainstBrexit was popular for a time. It started with a post that featured a sad-looking cat with the phrase, "My cat is sad because #Brexit. If you agree, retweet with your cat." Through creating, sharing, and liking emotionally evocative and playful online content, we let others know who we are and what we value. These messages may have special persuasive power when they are shared by family members, friends, and coworkers via social media. The repetition and affirmation of playful messages can also lead to the synchronization of opinion, which is a function of propaganda. Yet people may not be fully aware of how they acquire shared attitudes and beliefs through propaganda that blurs the boundaries between persuasion, entertainment, and information. Definitions of propaganda. Definitions of propaganda are situational and contextual, rooted in time and space. In Germany and around the world, the term is closely linked to the Third Reich. For those in Eastern Europe, the word is deeply nuanced with cultural memories of life under communism. In the United States, public relations professionals have worked hard to distance themselves from the word, even though it was the original term used for the profession. People of different cultural and political backgrounds may differ in their use of the term, and those of different generations may also have nuanced and sometimes divergent interpretations. That's why Neil Postman once wrote that, "Of all the words we use to talk about talk, the word propaganda is the most mischievous." Propaganda originally had a meaning that was rooted in truth with a capital T. As used by the Catholic Church in the 17th century, propaganda referred to the propagation of the faith, spreading the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Religious scholars have pointed out that the missionary spirit of spreading the good news is a form of beneficial propaganda, and it is baked into the very foundations of early Christianity through the Apostle Paul's systematic efforts to deliberately extend the gospel across all parts of the known world through land and sea. In his many travels to reach early Christian audiences, St. Paul was a pioneering propagandist. Even today, Christian propaganda can be understood as bringing the world a gift of spiritual redemption through advancing an ideology of love and forgiveness. During and immediately after World War II, communication scholars reflected on how the power of propaganda helped to strengthen democracy and fight fascism. In the U.S., Hollywood played an active role in supporting the war effort, working in close coordination with the government. After the war, the process of denazification in Germany involved actively promoting democratic values by repealing Nazi laws, obliterating swastikas, and changing street names. The U.S. government also created libraries in many German cities to help with the re-education process. As a result, some scholars described propaganda in quite positive terms as one means by which large numbers of people are induced to act together. But later in the 20th century, definitions of propaganda began to take a narrower focus, emphasizing intentional political manipulation through untruths and lies. One English philosopher described propaganda as the cold-blooded manipulation of popular impulse and thought by professional politicians. In the 1960s, when television's cultural and economic power was rising, and advertisers were tapping into psychoanalytic thought to persuade, propaganda was defined in relation to human psychology as a form of information that panders to our insecurities and anxieties. As concerns about commercial culture flooded into every sector of cultural life, propaganda was defined as intentionally designed communication that invites us to respond emotionally, immediately, and in an either-or manner. When new approaches to public relations were being pioneered in the 1980s, propaganda was defined in relation to it as the deliberate, systematic attempt to shape perceptions, manipulate cognitions, and direct behavior to achieve a response that furthers the desired intent of the propagandist. In the 21st century, as corporate and special interest lobbyists were accelerating the scope of their incursion into Washington, D.C. politics, definitions of propaganda acknowledged its indifference to ethics, truth, and morality as strategic communication that uses any means to accomplish its ends. Today, some people think that propaganda and public lying are synonymous, while others blame digital technologies for the rising influence of propaganda. Propaganda has been defined in relation to the abuse of power as shaping perceptions and actions through the manipulation of information, often involving some form of deception, lying, omission, distortion, or misdirection. The term computational propaganda has been used to refer to the manipulation of public opinion through platforms and digital devices. Algorithmic personalization enables propaganda to spread through personalized advertising and entertainment, as well as the differential display of filtered search results on search engines. But one person's propaganda can be another person's art, education, or news. Perhaps you have encountered a person who believes that your most reliable news source is a form of propaganda. Many forms of propaganda are designed for beneficial public purposes and rely on the delivery of truthful information and the transparent display of persuasive purpose. But philosophers like to point out that some forms of propaganda are rooted in flawed ideologies or false beliefs. Some forms of propaganda present structural inequalities, cultural hierarchies, and other social power dynamics as natural. Since we are inevitably positioned within these systems, we may accept attitudes and beliefs that prevent us from seeing these hierarchies and inequalities in all their complexity. For this reason, it takes considerable self-awareness and humility to engage in the examination of contemporary propaganda. Some forms of propaganda are straightforward, while other forms can be deviously sophisticated and tricky. Propaganda may appear to appeal to public values while actually seeking to undermine those values. For example, when Republican politicians claimed that America had a significant voter fraud problem, they proposed the use of tactics designed to suppress the vote. In this case, they used a particular social value, the integrity of elections, to actually undermine the integrity of elections. The study of persuasion and propaganda can help us better understand the myriad ways that humans seek to influence each other using the power of communication and expression. The expression of a worldview about democracy, feminism, capitalism, automation, racism, globalization, or a million other topics functions as a form of social power. Becoming aware of how power relations are baked into the meaning-making process is an important dimension of lifelong learning. But inherent subjectivity is also involved in the study of persuasion and propaganda, because we are situated within it, as both audiences and authors. Think of it this way. Propaganda is in the eye of the beholder. You may have interpreted that doctored National Archives image of the Women's March as a form of political propaganda, while I may see it merely as an innocent marketing display. You may see that video game as an entertaining thrill ride, while I may see its gratuitous display of violence as a dehumanizing spectacle that encourages people to love war. Although scholars and experts may quibble about the precise scope of their definitions, most agree that 1. Propaganda appears in a variety of forms. 2. It is strategic and intentional. 3. Propaganda aims to influence public opinions, attitudes, and behaviors. 4. It can be beneficial or harmful. 5. It may use truth, half-truths, or lies. 6. To be successful, propaganda taps into our deepest values, fears, hopes, and dreams. 7. Propagandists may use any means to accomplish their goals. Definitions of propaganda like this have their merits, but they have their disadvantages too. Through trial and error in the classroom, I have discovered that it shortchanges the learning experience to merely offer students a definition of propaganda on a PowerPoint slide or in a handout. Learners benefit from opportunities to wrestle with the various definitions that have developed over time and identify the features or elements that make sense to them. This helps them own their understanding of the term. When they appreciate that definitions of propaganda are constructed by people situated in a particular moment in time and space, they are more willing to construct definitions that relate to their lived experience. As they learn more about the topic, they are able to revise their personal definitions. This is why I like to engage learners in constructing their own definition of propaganda at the beginning and at the end of the semester. I like to ask learners to review a variety of definitions and underline or highlight ideas that resonate with them. They then remix phrases and ideas from the work of previous scholars and thinkers, selecting those that make sense to them. I then ask learners to discuss their choices with a partner to explain which elements of the definitions are most important to them. One student may call attention to the idea that propaganda taps into people's existing values, which also helps explain why propaganda is not always effective. Propaganda is not a magic bullet that affects all people in the same way. Another learner may point out that propaganda may use factual information, carefully selected and arranged. When a student points out that propaganda may use any means to accomplish its goal, there's an opportunity to introduce the importance of framing the study of propaganda through an ethical lens. The study of propaganda enables us to consider the moral and social responsibilities of communication by demonstrating respect for the whole human person. The study of contemporary propaganda is a near-perfect entree to explore ethics and moral philosophy because it helps learners reflect on the social responsibilities of both the people who create messages and those who consume them. But in order for genuine learning to occur, we must shed some of the negative connotations of the term itself. One thing is certain. Debating whether a particular message is or is not propaganda is educationally unproductive. People can't really wrestle with issues concerning the ethics of communication if they simplistically believe that propaganda is, by definition, bad, or that the use of propaganda is inherently immoral or unethical. The topic must be approached with intellectual curiosity and an open mind. Where propaganda can be found. Propaganda appears in a variety of forms. It can be found in news and journalism, advertising and public relations, and education, and in all aspects of daily life. It is present in information from government, business, religious and nonprofit organizations, and in many forms of entertainment, including music, TV shows, movies, video games, and social media, like YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter. Let's look at propaganda in 6 different places: advertising, journalism and public relations, activism, education, government, and entertainment. Journalism and public relations. Journalists have long recognized how to exploit the formula, "If it bleeds, it leads." Conflict, crime, and controversy are key factors that define what journalists consider to be newsworthy. But the rise of the internet has hobbled the business model for journalism, as the economic base of an independent press, advertising, has shifted toward online media. All daily newspapers have experienced declining revenues for more than a decade, and some broadcast news media outlets have survived by becoming more partisan in an effort to attract and hold key target audiences. Beginning in 1996, some television news stations shifted away from a focus on local crime news towards conservative topics, which had long been a successful formula in AM talk radio. Fox News appealed to viewers who were neglected by other journalistic enterprises, and their strategy of presenting partisan news helped an industry struggling with profitability to gain market share and persuade its viewers that they were fair and balanced. Other cable television news stations followed in their lead. Around the same time, philanthropists discovered they could influence the news agenda of public broadcasting. Joan Kroc, the wife of the fast food founder of McDonald's, bequeathed more than $200 million to National Public Radio, NPR, to ensure that Americans have access to quality news and journalism. There was never any suggestion that her gift came with strings attached. But after a philanthropy that strongly supported the Iran nuclear deal gave NPR a $100,000 grant, it seemed to many observers that NPR's coverage was noticeably skewed in favor of the deal. In fact, a large number of analysts and experts who were directly funded by that same philanthropy made it on the air to discuss the Iran nuclear deal without NPR's disclosing that connection. Leaders of the network admit that they have not always been transparent about who funds its journalism and how much the public is told about it. Few Americans understand how news and journalism benefit from the practice of public relations, PR, whose practitioners use many strategies to shape perceptions and influence public opinion on behalf of a business client. In the U.S., there are four PR professionals for every working journalist. Many people are surprised by that fact. Public relations people feed journalists information based on their clients' agenda. For example, many local newspapers and TV news organizations reported on JetBlue's stunt for Mother's Day, when they decided to reward passengers on a particular flight from JFK in New York to Long Beach, California, based on the number of times a baby cried. If four babies cried, all passengers on the flight got a free return ticket for their next JetBlue flight. By using events, stunts, contests, video news releases, blogging, newsletters, policy documents, and more, businesses send messages that carefully represent their interests, often by linking their products or services to particular emotions, values, or feelings. Advertising and marketing. You may wonder about the similarities and differences between advertising and propaganda. Advertising is a type of propaganda that supports sales and marketing goals. Commercial products play a meaningful role in people's lives, and we derive emotional satisfaction from certain products and promotional messages. Advertising relies on building inferential bonds between products and human values. It links feelings and images with companies and products to create brands. Some people think of a brand as a logo, but it's more precisely defined as a person's perception of a product, service, person, or organization. In 2016, the Target store chain spent $1.4 billion to buy advertising placements on television, billboards, radio, and magazines. For many customers, the big red bullseye means getting the stuff that you need for daily life at a cheap price. Your favorite brand addresses your identity in relation to the aspirational lifestyle you seek. One marketer explained that brands help you become more you. Today, advertisers track your clicks and likes when you are online to deliver highly customized messages that are designed to appeal to your desires. In doing so, they place you in a category based on who they think you are. For some people, this may satisfy the need for a common culture by connecting people together through products. Young mothers may be proud and happy to receive online ads for diapers and baby products, feeling like they are part of a small but important tribe. After all, advertising offers a sense of identity and community in an increasingly isolating and unstable world. In his book, The Attention Merchants, Tim Wu points out that while advertising can increase people's personal freedom by helping them become more aware of the choices available to them, it simultaneously serves up propaganda that perpetuates the centrality of consumer culture as a key facet of personal identity. In an important way, advertising is a form of propaganda for capitalism itself. Government and politics. Governments use propaganda in both very large, noticeable ways, and in very small and often unnoticeable ways. At various times in American history, the United States has generated war propaganda by defining battles as epic conflicts between good and evil, leading the public to accept its decision to use armed conflict as rational and justified. But local and national government also use nudges, which are small ways of structuring choice so that people make socially desirable decisions. For example, your water bill might include a chart showing how much water is used by an average family of various sizes so that you can compare your costs to others. You are being presented with information that offers a set of social norms. You're responding to influence if you actually change your behavior by taking shorter showers or watering the grass less frequently after seeing the chart. In many countries, nudges are used to implement public policies. In his book, The Ethics of Influence, Cass Sunstein points out that nutrition labels, fuel economy labels, and disclosures about the real cost of taking out a loan are tools that encourage a certain sort of good behavior. Such nudges are forms of propaganda that aim to shape someone else's beliefs and actions. Because we may not recognize their purpose, nudges can violate personal autonomy. The government also uses propaganda in more overt and recognizable ways. You may be familiar with public service announcements, PSAs, that aim to alter your behavior. In 2016, the Los Angeles Police Department launched a major campaign to increase public awareness of domestic violence. These billboards were eye-popping. One billboard was covered in bridal lace with the phrase, "You may now hit the bride," written to look like a wedding invitation. Another showed a stream of smartphone text messages that went from heart emojis to the controlling demand, "Where are you?" The campaign was designed to increase public awareness of the many forms of controlling behavior.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.